Church. It's great to see you guys this morning. It's great to be here to worship our God together as a body. We're going to open up. In fact, let me just make this quick announcement. You're free to take off your masks now if you'd like. Let's get your seats. If you want to keep it on, that's totally okay too. So just want to let you know that. We're going to go to the Word of God here, Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 through 5. It'll be up on the screen for you to follow along. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away." And he who was seated on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." What a beautiful, glorious passage of the coming restoration of all things by the hand of God, where we, as the church, as his people, as his children, are adorned as his fully sanctified, fully purified, fully mature bride of Christ, and we're presented before our Lord Jesus as his bride, where we get to be with him forever and ever. That's the future glory that awaits us. What a glorious destiny that is for us as believers. Amen. So I invite you to stand with us, and as we sing praises to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is the source of all our hope that we have.
Of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. Thou burning sun with golden gleam. Thou silver moon with softer gleam. shall fall on bending knee. All creatures of our God and King, oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son.
Welcome you guys again this morning. So grateful to see each and every one of your faces. And if you're new to the Hill, maybe it's your first time here this morning, we're especially grateful that you decided to join us. We hope you feel welcomed in. We're here because of really all that God has done for us in Christ and His redeeming work on the cross, His victory over sin and death through the empty tomb, and we get to take part in that life through faith in Him. Today we're going to go through our Harvest Spotlight, where we choose a church in our area to pray for, come alongside them in prayer. Today we're going to do Pillar Church. We're going to pray for them. They've asked for a specific request that we're going to lift up to the Lord together. They're a gospel community who is committed to preaching the gospel, committed to making disciples, to further the kingdom. So let's come alongside them and pray. Let's go to the Lord. Father God, we again gather this morning as your people to worship and to praise your holy name. We gather to give you all glory and honor, God, because of your high status as creator and ruler of all things. Your divine nature and eternal power have been made clear from the beginning. From creation itself, we see the inexpressible beauty of your handiwork. You are the Almighty One who has not only displayed your power in creation, but you've displayed your power over the rulers and authorities of this dark world, putting them to open shame, triumphing over them through the cross and through the empty tomb of our beloved Savior, Jesus Christ. God, we thank you for the way that you set us free from our sin, to be bound up with you where we belong as your children, redeemed and reborn. Help us this morning to worship you with sincere hearts, and with sincere gratitude and thankfulness in light of all you've done on our behalf. We pray this morning for Pillar Church and Pastor Daniel Carter. We ask, Lord, that you would bless them in their laboring to preach the gospel and make disciples. We pray that they would see lives changed and hearts turned towards you as your kingdom is furthered. Bless the work, God, and encourage them with the fruit of the gospel, the salvation of souls. We ask that you give their leadership wisdom in decision-making during this unique time in our lives, God. And we join them in praying for more leaders within their congregation to step up and labor in your kingdom in the areas where you've gifted them. We thank you even now, God, for this opportunity to be together, lifting our voices to you in praise and exaltation as we worship you as the Almighty God, whose rule and reign will never end. You are the Alpha and Omega. Praise be to you, God, in Jesus' name. Amen.
come behold the works of God, the nations at his feet. He breaks the bow and bends the spear and turns the words to sticks. O mighty one of Israel, you are on our side. We walk by faith in God who burns his enemies with fire. Lord of hosts, you with us in the fire, with us as a shelter, with us in the storm. You will lead us through the fiercest battle. Oh, where else would we go? God of Jacob's tears from grave, you lift your voice to speak. The earth it bows and all the mountains move into the sea. Oh Lord, you know the hearts of men, and you let them dip. Oh God, who makes the mountains melt, the rest of us in pain. Oh God, who makes the mountains melt, come rest with us, amen.
morning, church. We remain standing for a moment. My name is Pastor Jimmy. I'm one of the pastors here. It's a joy to be with you this morning. It's a joy to sing with you this morning. In the seat back in front of you, if you're a guest with us, we are especially glad you're here. There's a connect card there for you. We would love for you to fill this out. Put as much information on it as front and front and back as you can. Then after service, out the double doors to your left, there's a connect area. It's a place for us for you to drop this off, interact with someone there. It is a way for us to tangibly get to know you, share with you who we are as a church, and learn better how we can serve you as a body. There's also a prayer card in the seat back in front of you as well. We would love to be praying for you and praying with you, so we would ask you to do the same thing. Take that out, put as much information front and back as you can, out the double doors on the way out. There'll be a table set up. You can drop it off as well there. It's my privilege now to lead us to pray to our great God and Savior. So would you please bow your heads as we pray. Sovereign Lord, who made the heavens, the earth, and all that is in them, we lift our voices this morning solely through and solely because of the ongoing work of your Son, knowing that nothing happens apart from His permission and His purpose in this world. You are our faithful God in Christ. You are, Lord, you are a steadfast and sure hope in Christ. Lord, you have and you continue to demonstrate yourself as good to us and right in every way in Jesus Christ. And Father, we confess that due to our sin, we are not like you in so many ways. God, we are unfaithful. God, we are wrong. In both our attitudes and actions, we demonstrate our fallen, sinful nature every day. And God, we confess we have a deep aversion in us to humility. Pride tends to be our ongoing disposition, Lord. Our pride is simply the manifestation or the exposure of our deep insecurity. Instead of resting in your finished work, we rise up trying to execute our wants, our desires, our plans that we think are best for our lives. Father, forgive us for our small and often, if we're honest, myopic view of ourselves and this world. We tend to see the world in us and hear the rhetoric of our day and forget that you are the sovereign Lord. Or we tend to forget that we are, as we're reading in Romans, but wild olive shoots who have been graciously grafted into your redeeming work in history. It is not us who support the root. It is the root that supports us. Father, forgive us for being proud. Cause us to fear you. To fear and to rest in the sovereign, in your sovereign purposes for your people. In the midst of a faithful, faithless, and twisted generation. And Lord, we can trust. Lord, we can rest. And Lord, we can be sure and confident when we remain fixed upon the glory of your great name in Christ. Jesus, you possess and you portray the ultimate, pure, right understanding of humility. That you would come, the divine Son, second person of the Trinity, enter this world as a man, that you would be born as a man, that you would empty yourself by taking the form of a servant and humbling yourself to the point of death, but not just death, death upon the cross for sinners like us. And Jesus, you possess a pure, perfect fear of the Father and His eternal plan, which you share in for this world. We thank you, Jesus, for your righteous life, for your atoning death for sinners like us. And we thank you for the forgiveness of sin. We thank you that while we were yet enemies, Christ, you died for us. And through the work of the gospel, we stand forgiven and empowered by the Holy Spirit to live for your glory in this world. And Lord, we We turn to our petition this morning. That is our simple petition. Lord, that you would make us a people, that we would live for your glory. Help us to live in this world, not for our glory, not for the glory of this world, not even for the glory of this nation we call home, but for your glory. For you are the sovereign creator and righteous judge. But Father, even in that reality of living for your glory, we must be honest, we tend to twist that and live for our own. We like the noticeable, grand, popular things that we say we're doing for you, but often we're quick to pass over the simple, lowly, common call of the Christian life. Lord, help us to be courageous enough, to be mature enough, to live out the simple commands of our faith. Reminded of Romans chapter 12, verse 10, where we read that we are to let love be genuine. We are to abhor what is evil. We're to hold fast to what is good. Help us by your Holy Spirit to love one another with brotherly affection, because we belong to one another in Christ. Cause us not to constantly seek our own honor and self-interest, not to spend our energy trying to promote our preferences, but instead to be a people who outdo each other, who are competitive towards one another in doing honor to one another and showing honor. Father, keep us from being slothful in zeal, to be fervent in spirit. We want to serve you, Lord, not ourselves. We need you in order to do that. Cause us to rejoice in hope, be patient in tribulation, constant in prayer, contribute to the needs of the saints, and to seek and to show hospitality. Lord, by clothing ourselves in humility, let us serve one another, as our brother Peter tells us. Sovereign Lord, we know that none of this work in us will be done, can be done, will ever be done, apart from your word and your spirit. So it's to that end we turn our attention now, through the opening of your word, through the reading of your word, through the preaching of your word, might you shape us and mold us, pull up the roots, plant again the reality of the gospel in our hearts, to grow, to be nourished, and to be shaped. For we know that all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the people of God may be complete, may be equipped for every good work. Lord, is that in? We want to be. We want to be about the good work. So Lord, now as our preacher steps up to preach, I pray you would give him humility in himself, give him boldness in the text, give him assurance of your word. Lord, cause our hearts to be soft this morning to receiving of your word. I focus our attention now as we hear the gospel proclaimed, hear your word preached, Lord, that we might become who we are in you, that we might grow up into maturity in Christ, not just individually, Lord, as a body, that we might put on Christ and be found in him. Well, it's to that end now we turn our time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated, and now turn your attention to the screen. We'll be right back.
things that you've given to our family. We're super grateful for this time of the year. And we're trying to come to the preaching of God.
Good morning, Hill Church. It is with great joy I stand before you today. I also want to say how grateful I am to not only sing songs that exalt Jesus together, but since I've come here in the summer, you all have received me so well, and it is a great privilege for me to serve, to open up the Word of God, and it is indeed a grace to preach the unsearchable riches of Christ Jesus. So would you please turn with me to Romans chapter 8, verses 18 through 27. Romans chapter 8, verses 18 through 27, as we continue our series on becoming who we are in Christ. Romans 8, verses 18 through 27, title for this sermon being Hope-Filled Groans of Glory. Hope-Filled Groans of Glory. So let's pray, and then we'll read the word. Father God in heaven, in great humility we pray to you, but also great confidence and joy because of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is our advocate, who intercedes for us. We thank you, Lord, that we can sing "It is well with our souls" because it is finished, because of what Jesus has done on the cross, paying in full the wage for our sin, which was death. We have a good shepherd who laid down his life for us, and he is alive now forevermore. So for that we say thank you, Lord. We thank you, Father, that you have revealed yourself to us clearly in creation and in our conscience, but especially in your word. We thank you for an authoritative, a true scripture inspired by the Holy Spirit, which speaks life to us. The words of eternal life. We read of your word, we see the glory of Christ and say, to whom else shall we go? So, Father, we come to you today indeed as beggars, wanting the bread of life in Christ and your word. And we ask that you would help us, Holy Spirit, illuminate our hearts and minds that we may understand your word rightly. Heavenly Father, help us in the preaching of your word, the hearing of your word, the applying of your word. Apart from you, Jesus, we can do nothing. Let us abide in you even as we hear from your word. And our preeminent prayer, Lord, is that Christ would be exalted in the salvation of people here today, in the sanctification of the saints, and in that you be glorified. In Christ's name, amen. Romans 8, 18 through 27, the text reads, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself would be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God." So reads the word of the living God. It's all too easy to be tired and to groan in a fallen world. Because life in a fallen world is not easy. Particularly for Christians, since we no longer look to this world as our home. Nevertheless, it's where we are now. And currently, for example, we groan collectively through a pandemic and political tension, but always as Christians, amidst our sanctification, we groan because of remaining sin. In us and all around us. And because of sin, suffering abounds in this fallen world. When I say groan, some of you may not know what I mean, but I'm sure we've all experienced it in this room. A groan is a sigh of grief, expressions of deep sorrow at the circumstances that we find ourselves in. Expressions of anguish due to physical, emotional, circumstantial, relational, or spiritual pain. And if we're honest with ourselves, we've all found ourselves in that state of existence a time or two, if not many, many, many more. Groans are expressions of present pain coupled with future longing. But for Christians, our groans are expressions of grief mingled with hope. Because Jesus has saved us and sent his Holy Spirit to dwell in us. And we've seen that the Holy Spirit moves us to kill sin, pushes us to cry out to God, Abba Father, and assures us that we are co-heirs with Christ. But no servant is greater than his master. Like Jesus, our cross is before the crown. And our groanings testify to the fact that we must suffer with and for Christ before we reign with him forever. So, it's the real prospect of suffering and slow process of sanctification that makes us groan for our glorification. See, to put it simply, salvation is freedom from the penalty of sin by grace through faith in Christ. Sanctification is the ongoing process of freedom from the power of sin in our lives. But glorification is freedom from the very presence of sin when we're brought into the presence of Christ and made like him. Our groanings. And the real prospect of suffering and the slow process of sanctification makes us groan for glorification. And that glorification is the future longing of our present sufferings. Brothers and sisters, know this today, that there's hope in the midst of your sighs and groans. And this text presents the hope amidst our groanings. Our central truth for today is that believers must groan for glory with hope, knowing creation groans with us and the Spirit groans for us. As Christians, we must groan for glory with hope, knowing creation groans with us and the Spirit groans for us. In other words, this text teaches us creation groans with us and the Spirit groans for us so that we'll groan for glory with hope. And with that being said, we come to our first point in verses 18 through 22, the groanings of creation. Verse 18 reads, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us." Paul in verse 18 gives perspective on the whole of this passage. It's his thesis for the section of verses 18 through 27. And clearly, Paul is looking forward to our glorification. The suffering doesn't compare with the glory that is to be revealed to us. In verse 17, speaking of the Spirit assuring us that we're co-heirs with Christ, says that we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. And in Romans 3:23, it says that we've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But Romans 5:2, on the basis of Christ's work, we now rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Paul is speaking of glorification here. That's what he's looking forward to. And notice the words in verse 18, "For I consider." Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit and in exemplary fashion, he considered this. He thought carefully and critically. He measured and calculated and rightly concluded that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. When Paul says the sufferings of this present time, take note that he is not downplaying nor disregarding suffering even for the Christian in the fallen world. That would not be healthy nor biblical to do so. But hear me here, whether your sufferings are persecution for Christ, being slandered or eventually martyred for Christ, or whether it's heartbreak, loneliness, the hardships of parenting, the pain of divorce, the chronic pain of dealing with health issues in our bodies, the death of loved ones, disease, issues in your own mind, mental health problems, relational strife, relational struggles, loved ones not being saved, or even just the slowness of your sanctification, remaining sin in your life that leads you to come back to the Lord for the same things. Wherever you are, the Bible speaks to us today and proclaims that your present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us, dear Christian. That is a certainty that this glory will most certainly be revealed to us. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17, this light and momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. See, our present sufferings and future glory, they're not in the same category. They're not in the same class. They can't be compared. They can only be contrasted. It's like me playing basketball at Clay Park in LeBron James. You can't compare that. You can only contrast it. It's like the awkward feelings of trying to strike up an evangelistic conversation with a stranger. And then 5 minutes later, after telling them the gospel, they come to faith in Christ. It's like comparing those awkward feelings to the joy you would have at seeing death to life, unbelief to belief, a new creation in Christ Jesus. There's no comparison there. Samuel Rutherford said this: 1 year's time of heaven shall swallow up all sorrows, even beyond all comparison. The passage we read earlier tells us of the hope that one day every tear will be wiped away. Death will be no more. Mourning, crying, and pain will be over. All things will be made new. And we'll see Jesus as he truly is and savor him forever. Relative to eternity, though the suffering is real, one pastor said, well, the suffering is short, but our glory is forever. Our suffering is in mortal and decaying bodies, but our glory is in perfected and imperishable bodies. Even in the darkest suffering with Jesus, the best remains and the best is yet to be. Glory awaits us in Christ. This is the Christian perspective. This is our hope amidst the groans. And support for this statement in verse 18 surrounds us in creation itself. Look with me to verse 19. Paul says, for the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. And Paul says the creation here, he's referring to everything in the universe. Subhuman, meaning animals, plants, the ocean, mountains, stars, moon, the planets, all in the solar system, galaxies, the sun itself. Paul here is personifying creation as waiting with eager longing for our glorification. And when Paul says waits with eager longing, the picture in the original is Paul personifying creation as being on its tiptoes with an outstretched neck to see the beautiful sight of us, the children of God, fully becoming who we are in our glorified bodies. Creation is on its tiptoes, extending itself to hopefully catch a glimpse. It's the picture Paul is painting there. It's for the revealing of the sons of God. The sons and daughters of God, and that word revealing means the disclosing, the uncovering, the unveiling of the children of God. So the plant that you water, the flower that you admire, the stars that you gaze upon, not in the city, somewhere far from here, they all eagerly wait for us to be unveiled in glory. Creation has eager longing to see our glorification. In the book of Daniel, chapter 12, verse 3, he speaks of the people of God, when all things are made new, shining like the brightness of the sky. And Jesus himself says his disciples will shine like the sun in God's kingdom. This is what creation is eagerly longing for. Paul continues in verse 20. And says, for the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope, verse 21, that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. Paul is telling us in verse 20 that God subjected creation to futility, to emptiness and not being able to fulfill its purpose. God subjected creation to futility when he cursed the ground because of Adam's sin. So Paul is looking back here to Genesis 3, specifically Genesis 3, verses 17 through 19, which reads, and to Adam, God said, because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten of the tree of which I commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field. God subjected creation to futility when he cursed the ground. It was the whole of creation. That's why it's unable to fulfill its original purpose and goal of supremely and perfectly glorifying God. That's why work now is filled with thorns and thistles and vanity, emptiness, life being a breath dominates the world, like Solomon told us in Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 2. But verse 20 ends with, in hope. There's hope for creation. And that hope was also in Genesis 3. Genesis 3, verse 15, where God promised the Savior, the seed of the woman who would crush the head of the serpent and redeem humanity. But in Colossians 1:20, in speaking about the supreme redemption of Christ, it speaks of Christ bringing about a cosmic reconciliation with all of creation itself. And this hope of creation is spelled out further in verse 21 that we read. Creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. See, creation is in bondage to corruption. That's why you go outside and look at the natural world anywhere in this world, you'll see that the world is dominated by decay, disease, natural disasters, air pollution, tornadoes, droughts, avalanches, fires, earthquakes, and death itself. We live in a cursed world that's in bondage to corruption. However, the beauty that remains in the world, the scenic trails that we take, and the beautiful sights that we take in, scream to us that it was meant to be better than this, and better is to come. But when the glory comes, creation is set free from the curse and from corruption. But that only happens when we, God's image bearers and God's children, are finally free in our glorification. Creation isn't made new until God's children are glorified. And it's because of all of this that we read in verse 22. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. The going green movements of our world prove this to be true. But the ultimate answer is not found in those, nor in us throwing stuff into our blue trash can, but for us to be glorified in the fullness of redemptive history to come about. This is the groaning of creation. Up until this very moment, all of the decaying, the disasters, and death are groans, sighs of grief and future longings for glory, for us to be glorified. Paul compares in this text, verse 22, creation's groaning to the pains of childbirth, something that the Steeles, Julie knows afresh nowadays, and all of you mothers in the room. But Paul is metaphorically intentional when he compares it to the pains of childbirth. For one, that also goes back to Genesis 3, because the pain of childbirth is a part of the curse due to the fall of man. Two, the pain of childbirth is deep, it's real, but it's not ever final and permanent. It brings about a surpassing joy in the birth of the child. And it's the same way with the groanings and longings of creation. Notice, Paul says, birth pains, not death pains. The present curse of creation tells us that there is a coming glory for creation and for us. When that glory comes, surpassing joy will be had, like when the child finally comes and is held by its mother. This is the groaning of creation. And this truth calls us to a few things. One, we have to thoroughly consider the hope that you have, even amidst suffering. Thoroughly consider, like Paul did, think intentionally, calculate, reason, consider the hope you have, even amidst the suffering that you may be going through today. Whatever you're going through, be not stuck in your suffering, but contemplate, meditate on the glory ahead, seeing and savoring Christ, being made fully new in a glorified body with no more sin, no more worries, no more suffering, where every tear will be wiped away. Let this hope kill all comparisons between the present suffering and the future glory that is ahead of us as children of God. But also, see the cursed state of creation as groans for your glorification. When you see the decay and the disasters and the death that abounds in our world, see it as groans for our glorification, for us to be made fully new, so that creation will also be made free, because that's what it is. Creation declares the glory of God, Psalm 19, but it also groans for the glorification of the children of God. See that as you walk in your Father's world. Creation longs for the fullness of redemptive history to come, and we should too. Remembering that believers must groan for glory with hope, knowing creation groans with us and the Spirit groans for us, we've seen the groanings of creation. We come to our second point now in verses 23 through 25, the groanings of God's children. Verse 23 reads, "And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies." Paul says it's not only creation, but we ourselves, and he's emphatic there. It's us. Creation is not alone in its groans. We groan too. And that begs the question, do you groan in your life? Do you groan over remaining sin, O Christian, in your life? Do you groan to be glorified and to be with Jesus? To groan means that you are God's child, just like to battle sin means that you've been born again. Do you groan in your life? Do you groan over remaining sin? Do you groan amidst suffering with the hope of your eternal home? Or do you just long for more comfort here? Because if you do, you may be too comfortable in this place that is not your home. Paul is emphatic here that believers groan for glory. We groan as those who have the first fruits of the Spirit, Paul says. Paul says first fruits here because within nature it's the first few pieces of fruit that provide hope, that provide the hope that a harvest is coming. First fruits only show that there's more to come. So spiritually speaking, the first fruits of our redemption is the sealing of the Holy Spirit. He's the seal and guarantee of our salvation. Ephesians 1 says he's the down payment of our salvation. And also just the fact that we've been regenerated, we've been born again, and we have faith that's a gift of God's grace, and that we're being sanctified. We're not where we hope to be, but we're not where we were either. And our lives are filled with love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. These are the fruits of the Spirit, and they're the first fruits of the Spirit, of our redemption. Amen. Because we have these first fruits, which tell us that there's more to come, we groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. When Paul says groan inwardly here, this is deep. It gets down to our very souls. We sigh. We grieve. We're frustrated even in our hearts, in our minds, in the deepest depths of our person and being. And this groaning looks like Paul in Romans 7, verse 24. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? That's him groaning there. Or 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 2, where Paul says, for in this tent we groan, longing to put on our heavenly dwelling. He compares our bodies to a tent, fragile and temporary. And later in that passage in 2 Corinthians 5, he compares our heavenly dwelling, our heavenly bodies, with a building that's stable, fixed, and firm. We wait eagerly for our adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. And we should be waiting, eagerly anticipating the consummation of our adoption. We've seen last week and earlier in Romans 8 that we've already been adopted in Christ. That is a spiritual reality right now. But the completion of our adoption is when we're glorified with new bodies like the resurrected Christ. This is the redemption of our bodies that Paul is talking about. And 1 Corinthians 15 gives us a few commentaries on what he's getting at here. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 49 says, just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, Adam, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven, Jesus. We should be eagerly waiting to have a body like the resurrected Christ rather than like Adam, as we do now. And in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 53, it says, for this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. Believer, your glorified body will be immortal, eternal. We're not going to be Casper the Friendly Ghost, just floating spirits, but real, physical, glorified bodies in a new heavens and new earth with glorified hearts, minds, and emotions. No more temptations, anxieties, mental health issues, or misplaced or troubled emotions. Glorified. And this is glorious. This is our hope. This is not a wish or a possibility, but our hope and confident expectation and certainty based upon the faithfulness of our God and His Word. The Spirit within us is only the beginning. And the Spirit within us is the guarantee that God will finish His holistic redemption within us, both body and soul. So in this in-between stage, already, not yet, we groan, but we groan with hope. Verses 24 and 25, Paul continues and says, "For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience." Paul says, "For in this hope we were saved." When we were saved by grace through faith in Christ with the hope of eternal life, that hope also encompassed eternal glory and being changed forever with glorified bodies. Then Paul says, "Now hope that is seen is not hope." And what he means there is we don't look in the mirror and we don't look to each other and see one another in glorified bodies shining as bright as the sun. We need lights for a reason. We don't possess our glorified bodies yet, but it's our hope and confident expectation and certainty that God will finish the good work. It's not a present reality yet. That's why we groan with hope. But this life, it's not going to bring us the experience of glorification, only the hope of it. But it's certain and real and true. In verse 25, Paul says, "But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience." John Stott said really well, "We are confident in God's promises that the first fruits will be followed by the harvest, bondage by freedom, decay by incorruption, and labor pains by the birth of a new world." Our groans and sufferings have an expiration date when our hope is realized. Paul, in the latter half of verse 25, says, "We wait for it with patience." And this tells us that you should be eager for glory, but not impatient with God. You should be patient, but not apathetic, sitting around on a couch and just doing nothing. You should be eager. We should be patient also with hope. And this looks like trusting that God knows what he's doing in all of redemptive history, in his timing and all of his ways. And trusting that he will indeed finish the good work he started in us. And giving thanks in all circumstances. 1 Thessalonians 5:18, even the in-between stage. And also knowing that the best is yet to come in glory with Jesus. Not anything that this world offers, for here we'll be groaning with hope. So by way of application, this text calls you not to be complacent with sin or suffering in this world, and especially not in your life, but to groan for glory. And what this really looks like practically is praying and hoping for the return of Christ. For that is when our glorification happens, when Jesus returns. How often do you think about the return of Jesus? Honestly. Martin Luther said, "We should live as if Jesus died this morning, rose this afternoon, and is coming back tonight." How often do you think about the return of Jesus? Revelation 22:20, the second to last verse in the whole Bible, says, "Come, Lord Jesus." And look at what Scripture has upon the return of Christ and what that means for us. Philippians 3, verses 20 and 21 says, "But our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself." Colossians 3:4, "When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory." 1 John 3:2, "Beloved, we are God's children now. And what we will be has not yet appeared, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him because we shall see him as he is." Think, hope, and pray and long for the return of Christ in your life. But along with praying and hoping for the return of Christ, worship while you wait. Worship while you wait. Lamentations 3:25 says, "The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him." Waiting isn't doing nothing. It's worshiping and seeking the Lord. Because God is good even amidst our groans. Christ our Savior is lovely even amidst all our sufferings. And the gospel and God's goodness has brought us so many riches now, right now. There is beauty and in between. But we also must do this together. Throughout this text thus far, every time Paul has said us and we. And in the final part of verse 25, he says, we wait for it with patience. This speaks to how vital the local church is in the life of the Christian. There is no room for isolated Christianity, period, nor in groaning for glory. We groan, suffer, pray, long, and worship, and wait together. We press on, we groan for glory together. So remembering that we are to groan for glory with hope, knowing that creation groans with us and the Spirit groans for us. We've seen the groanings of creation and the groanings of God's children. We come to our final point in verses 26 through 27, the groanings of the Holy Spirit. Verse 26 reads, likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We'll pause there. Paul says likewise here because he's saying as Christian hope sustains us, so does the Holy Spirit. And notice what he says. The Spirit helps us in our weakness. You have to appreciate Paul here saying us. The Holy Spirit helps even the great Apostle Paul in his weakness. But this is an amazingly comforting verse. God, the Holy Spirit, helps us in our weaknesses. It doesn't say that he's perpetually disappointed with us or with you. It doesn't say that he's disappointed with you in your weaknesses or disgusted with you because of your weaknesses, or he deems you a failure in your weaknesses, or that he hates you for your weaknesses, but he helps us in our weaknesses. He strengthens us. He doesn't set you aside. He's a lifeguard, not an umpire that just calls you out. He's a tutor, not just a strict grader. He constantly, continually, and always helps us in our weaknesses. In the next portion of verse 26, Paul zeroes in on a specific area of weakness, being our prayer life. He says, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought. And that's all the time. It's not just sometimes, but in our weaknesses, we consistently don't know what to pray for as we ought. We don't know what to pray for as we should. It's because of our frailty and our finite minds and our imperfect perspectives and spiritual limitations that leads us to not pray as we should, period. And definitely not pray in proportion to the depth of our neediness. We never do it as we ought. And even when we do, we don't always have an adequate understanding of God's will. Like Paul praying in 2 Corinthians 12, take this thorn away from me, but Jesus had a purpose in it to show him that his grace was sufficient and that God's power is made perfect in weakness. I mean, how often do you look back on your life and are you grateful that God did not answer certain prayers when you prayed them? Because it would have ended up terrible for you, his kingdom, and everybody else. God knows what he's doing, even when we don't know what to say or what to pray for or just aren't aligned with his will and our prayers and desires. And this is because, Paul says in verse 26, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. God, the Holy Spirit, petitions, prays, and intercedes for us, for you, dear Christian, to God the Father with groanings that are too deep for words. These are divine articulations within the Trinity for us. And the Holy Spirit so deeply prays for you that they're called groanings. It's actually the same word used in Exodus 2:24, speaking of the nation of Israel in slavery in Egypt, groaning out to be delivered and freed. This verse says human language can't even adequately express the Holy Spirit's petitions on our behalf. They're unspeakably deep. And the Holy Spirit's intercession with groans parallels the intercession of Jesus for us, his church. That's going on right now. If you're to ask the question, what is Jesus doing right now? He's interceding for us at the right hand of the Father. That's what Paul tells us in Romans 8, 34. And Hebrews tells us that Jesus also helps us and sympathizes with us in our weaknesses. And he lives to make intercession for us. And as Paul says in Romans 8, 35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? The intercession of the Holy Spirit parallels the intercession of our Lord. And as believers, we have a double portion of intercession within the Trinity. Two intercessors, one in heaven, Jesus at the right hand of God, praying for us, and one in our hearts, the Holy Spirit interceding for us with groans too deep for words. And the Father is pleased and overjoyed to hear it. So be encouraged, Christian, that whatever you're going through, there's not a day that you're unprayed for by the Holy Spirit himself and Jesus our Lord. This is unspeakable security and assurance. Paul continues in verse 27 and says, and he who searches hearts knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And Paul says, he who searches hearts here, he's speaking of God the Father, who searches our hearts, and our Father knows our groans. But he also knows the mind of the Spirit, because they're in full agreement. They have one divine nature and one divine will. And the Spirit perfectly articulates God's will in his intercession on our behalf, even when we often don't. Which is good news, because we don't always get it right, even in our prayers. But the Spirit does, on our behalf. But I also want to draw attention to the word saints here. The Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. For one, saints are all Christians. It's not just a special class of people who have been saved. That is blatantly false teaching. But also, if you're here today and you have not embraced Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you're here today and you've not believed upon the Lord Jesus alone for your salvation, you are not a saint. You are a sinner, and that's it. And this text doesn't apply to you. The Holy Spirit does not intercede or groan for you. Rather, as John 16:8 says, the ministry of the Holy Spirit is to convict you of your sin before a holy God, to convict you of the very righteousness of God and of the coming judgment that will occur upon Jesus' return. You don't have a glorified body to look forward to apart from Christ, but a new body only fit for eternal judgment. And creation doesn't groan for the redemption of your body. You'll just perish along with the decaying state of creation. But the good news of the gospel is that the holy, infinite, wise, all-powerful God, who created us for his glory and to enjoy him forever, even though you have sinned against him, committed cosmic treason, and went your own way, God in his infinite wisdom, mercy, and grace and love sent his only son, gave up his son, and Christ came. And he lived the perfect life, loving God with all of his heart, soul, mind, and strength, loving others as he loved himself, always. Jesus was tempted in every way, and yet without sin, the most beautiful, perfect life, fulfilling the law of Moses and the prophets. And Jesus, in that exquisite perfection, laid down his life. Jesus, in his infinite love, gave up his life and died on the cross as a substitute for all who will believe in him. We cry out, it is well with our souls because of what Jesus has done. He died on the cross, and one of his final words was, it is finished, paid in full the price for our sin. And he rose on the third day, as he said he would, because his sacrifice was sufficient. He is the Son of God. He is the Savior. And the good news is that the statement is trustworthy, deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, to forgive sinners, and to call sinners. And the gospel call is for you to repent, to turn from your sin, to turn from any notion that you can work your way to God, and to throw yourself upon Christ in faith and reliance and trust. And Jesus is faithful to save you. This is the goodness of Christ in the gospel. Come to the Lord today. Do not walk away from his mercy. The gospel is good news for the sinner. It's good news. Come to Christ today. For my brothers and sisters in Christ, as we look upon the groaning of the Holy Spirit, recognize your weakness before God so that you'll depend upon the help of the Holy Spirit. Paul Washer said, your problem isn't that you're weak. It's that you don't recognize how weak you are. Recognize your weakness that you may depend upon God, his Spirit, and his Word. And like Paul in 2 Corinthians 12, the thorn in his flesh stayed so that he may see the sufficient grace of Jesus and know that the power of God is perfected when we are weak. That's why he boasted, when I am weak, then I'm strong. Recognize your weakness, but also remember and rejoice in that you are prayed for. Think upon Jesus and the Holy Spirit who helps us and intercedes for us. And because of that, God's will shall be done in your life. You don't just mess it up. Be encouraged in your groaning for glory that the Spirit groans for you. Think upon that every day. So we've seen the groanings of creation, the groanings of God's children, and the groaning of the Holy Spirit. As believers, we must groan for glory, knowing that creation groans with us and the Spirit groans for us. And yes, it's easy to be tired of it all within life in the fallen world, but it's better to have hope, because even amidst our groanings, as Christians, we can smile, for we have the hope of glory in Christ. And may Jesus Christ be praised. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your grace. Thank you for the goodness that you have shown us in your Son. We thank you that even creation groans for our glorification. We thank you that the Holy Spirit groans for us, intercedes, and helps us. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to hold on to hope amidst our groanings. We thank you that you are faithful to do it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand with us as we sing one more song together. As we behold our glorious Savior, Jesus Christ.
Turn your eyes upon.
Joy to sing with you today. Grateful to be able to worship with you today. I'm going to close us out in a word of prayer. Before I do, thank you for your offering. We'll pray over our offering as well. You'll understand because of the times we're in, we're not passing a plate necessarily. So continue to give online as you have been giving. If you are wanting to give in person today, you're prepared to do that. When you go out the door here to your right, there's an office door here with a little slot in it. You can drop it in there. Be glad to take it that way as well. If you're a visitor, I'd love to meet you after service. So I'll be up front, be around the area right here. I would love to meet you, shake your hand, get to know you. And let's close this out in a word of prayer. Jesus, you are our prize. You are our glory, the one we lift our eyes to. And Lord, we're so grateful that there's many things in this world that people call a prize. There's many things that we're told to pursue as a prize, but in the end, when we open them up, they are not satisfying. They will not fulfill eternally. We're so grateful, Lord Jesus, that you are the one who ultimately, completely, fully, all the way satisfies us. We thank you that you're yours, that we are yours. And it's all through the work of your Holy Spirit in our lives. So Lord, even this week, help us to turn our eyes. Help us to embrace the groaning within us in this fallen world, because it testifies that we are yours and that we are made for another world. Lord, might you shape us and mold us into the image of your Son this week. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege it is to gather as your people, to sing praises to you, our King, to sit under your word and to be instructed. Lord, might we do it all so that we might live more faithfully for you in this world. We love you, Jesus. We thank you for the life we share in you. It's in his name we pray, and everyone said, amen. Amen. Please put your mask back on as we mingle in fellowship before we leave today. Thank you.